a full-scale symphony orchestra concert. It is always 100 people who have given their lives to be there to do this amazing thing for us, you know, and for that community that we all create in the moment of a concert.
Hello, and welcome to Saffron Hall. I'm here today with Tom Service, writer and broadcaster, and also John Harte, chief executive of Aurora Orchestra. And we're here today recording the second of our spring digital broadcasts. So, John, if I could talk with you first. I mean, this has been a really, really tough time for freelance musicians, and Aurora is a freelance orchestra. Perhaps you could give us an overview of how the musicians have been and how this time's been for you.
Yeah, where to start? I mean, it's certainly an understatement to say it's been a challenging year, and I think we always have to draw a distinction really between the organisation and the freelance musicians who make up our player pool. I mean, from an organisational point of view, first of all, Aurora, you know, all orchestras are a bit different, but Aurora pre-pandemic used to generate about 70% of its income from live engagements, you know, whether box office or touring fees. And so, of course, there was this incredible trauma early on of having almost all of our income taken away overnight. And of course, organisationally, you then do your best to adapt as quickly as you can. And I think, by and large, over the last year, we've managed to do that. It's been a painful process along the way, but we've been very fortunate, you know, as many organisations have been, to benefit from some government support along the way, and that has helped enormously. I think the thing that keeps me up at night now is that the freelance, the position for the freelancers is much more patchy. And whilst some musicians have been able to get some support from the government, there's a big chunk, you know, a sizable minority, probably about 30%, the Musicians Union thinks, that haven't had any form of support from government schemes. And I think that's something we really need to reflect on as a society and do more about.
Yes, and we should say that this concert's going, being streamed for free, and 50% of the donations that we're asking for will go to Help Musicians UK, which I know are doing a huge amount at the moment for freelance musicians. So I hope that goes some way to help, but that's obviously a very short-term fix.
Absolutely.
And I imagine musically that it's been a very traumatic time for musicians to not be able to play together.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. I think it's just extraordinary having your whole kind of raison d'etre pulled away from you. And I think, you know, the flip side of that, the silver lining, I suppose, is that we all feel, both those of us behind the curtain and those on stage, I think a real renewed sense of purpose and commitment. I mean, a concert like today feels almost sort of miraculous, really. And we all feel this kind of, I think, deep-seated determination to get back to the kind of larger scale events we were doing here at Saffron Hall just last summer. You know, we just memories of things like the Berlioz Symphony Fantastique that we had here.
Incredible.
Seems sort of almost unimaginable now, but hopefully actually will come again sooner rather than later. I think a renewed sense of purpose certainly has been a feature of the last year. And digital work as well. I mean, you know, it's wonderful what you've been able to achieve here at Saffron Hall in terms of keeping live activity going. I think a lot of orchestras have kind of wrestled with this question of what actually does digital work mean for us. And certainly we as an organisation have moved from a position of more or less treating digital, I suppose, as an adjunct to our live programme and something that we use to drive traffic to our live programme. I think now we're having much, much more interesting conversations about what you can do digitally itself, how you can really make the most of that medium. And in fact, most of my time the last 2-3 months has been spent reimagining our children's program, our family storytelling series, as a series of online resources for teachers to help primary teachers embed music in the classroom, for, you know, to give an example. So I think there are those bright lights and you know, positive silver linings along the way.
We've had a very similar experience with our community and schools work where that's all moved online. And for example, our dementia project, Together in Sound, we've managed to keep people living with that condition actually in our Together in Sound programme for much longer online than they would have been able to achieve if they'd been coming in person. And that's been one of the positives we've taken from it. And I hope that when we go back to normal, whatever that looks like, that we can retain some of those advantages, if you like, that we've got from digital without... but combining them with the live experience, which we've all missed so much. Tom, perhaps I could come to you. How's the pandemic been for you?
Well, look, I feel enormously privileged, just lucky to be able to be working for Radio 3, to be making programmes remotely and very occasionally at Broadcasting House. Of course, at the BBC, we've seen an enormous impact in terms of what's happened to the live music that's been broadcast, the activity of our salaried orchestras and everything that they've been able to do and not been able to do. But I must say, hearing you both talk has just made me think about the things that are really imperiled, you know, freelance musicians, large-scale music making in schools. You know, this is a school hall as well as being this wonderful concert hall. But also the your work with education online and dementia. I mean, there are many other halls and orchestras who are doing similar work, the Manchester Camerata, and some of the positives are surely going to be that that we're all attuned, far more attuned to those people who are finding, who cannot access buildings like these on a day-to-day basis, just exactly like you said about your dementia community who are working here. So I mean, that's definitely going to be surely one positive that keeps going in terms of, you know, all of the activity of orchestras and concert halls being more available to wider parts of our all of our communities all the time. Nonetheless, I have to say, it does make me think that one of the things, John, you're saying about the renewed sense of purpose, for sure, it's also, it seems to me that the most active and the most imaginative concert halls, individuals, however you want to look at it, have been smaller scale and entrepreneurial. And that actually, if I was now casting, if I was in control of government purse strings or whatever else it might be, it strikes me that the things that urgently need to be supported are freelance musical culture, the widest possible access across the greatest range of our populations, and individual musicians and those who are closest to their communities. In other words, if we thought about turning the pyramid of musical culture almost entirely on its head, so that the value of everything that you all do as concert halls and orchestras wherever you are is going to be seen. You know, what impact are you having in your communities? What difference are you making? Instead of it being, well, you know, I was on tour in Shanghai last week. Well, first of all, why should we be touring to China now anyway? That's a purely personal view. I mean, all kinds of questions, let alone climate and all those other things. But the real value is, well, what difference are we making where we are, you know, as musicians, as concert halls? And that's what urgently needs to be funded. You know, that's the work that you really think that if that could be one of the things that comes out of this, that a greater realization of the human contact and power of music making at the most visceral and immediate level, and that can happen now digitally as well with all of those other people who need access to it. Well, that would be a positive, but it's going to need genuine rethinking, not just, you know, we go back to doing it as we were, oh, by the way, and there's much less money. No, it cannot be that, you know, seems to be.
It cannot, because I don't think any of us could do it with just less money, but back to normal. But I think what you say is absolutely right, Tom, is that it's the people who are closest to their community who are now going to be the first back, the first responders, if you like, to this crisis, and are really going to understand what their place in the community is. If you don't have a place in your community right now, then you're nowhere. You have no purpose. But if you know who your audience are, you know who all your different audiences are, your digital ones, your live ones, your school ones, your community ones, then they need you right now. Art is the best response to the many of the problems that our communities are going to have coming out of this pandemic. So I think that the smaller, the closer, the more local, the people that have the communities, they're going to be the strong ones. And John, I'm sure that you're feeling that at Aurora as well. You're thinking
absolutely
about your audiences.
And I think one of the, you know, again, in terms of silver linings, I think one of the things that we've felt strongly is that the last year has given us actually an unusual amount of time to reflect and think about these things strategically. You know, I think it's often the case in the orchestral world, I'm sure it's the same for you, Angela, and certainly in the broadcasting world, Tom, that you're on this kind of never-ending hamster wheel of looking from one concert to the next, and a lot of that is touring, as you say, Tom, which I think that in my mind is a huge question now about how we approach touring generally, and we certainly need to think both from a sort of community's point of view, but also from an environmental point of view about the sustainability of that long term. But yes, you know, we certainly now find ourselves thinking, what actually do we want to achieve in terms of a legacy? What impact do we want to have on what communities? And that has, you know, I'd like to think that in 5 years' time, we'll look back and say, this was a moment that actually really forced us to think carefully as a sector about what we wanted to do and actually sparked a positive change on that front. That would be the best outcome anyway.
It does come back also just to the human power of what music making is, that we're having this conversation, having experienced music making today. You know, and it restores to me the sense of what we may have taken, I took for granted. You know, a full-scale symphony orchestra concert, that isn't a single thing happening, Bruckner, Mahler, whatever else it is. It is always 100 people who have given their lives to be there to do this amazing thing for us. You know, and for that community that we all create in the moment of a concert, it is a consecration of all the best things about us. And I think to realize that these human voices, these extraordinary individuals, all of that human power that music always has, it feels to me that is absolutely being renewed and restored now, as we just realize, my God, this is amazing. This whole thing is so extraordinary. So for however fragile it is, it has become absolutely more powerful. Mm. I mean, today it just proves that to me again, just this thing about being in the room with the musicians. You know, this is not, we are privileged, it's always a privilege, but my goodness, how urgent and essential it is, as you say.
It's urgent, it's essential, and I think it really, you know, we've had it taken away, we've had this fire break, if you like, and now we're coming back digitally and we're all really appreciating what we've got. And what we need to do as well, I think, to hang on to this. And I'm sure the audiences will feel the same. Certainly Saffron Hall audiences say to me all the time, you know, they can't wait to get back. They can't wait to see musicians live. Mm. They're watching the digital programs that are coming out now and they're appreciating those, but they want to get back into concert halls. And there's just a new relationship, I think, between musicians and audiences now. You can really feel that, and that's fantastic.